Hillbillies.
Exactly what happened with Ms. Drysdale?
Well, I come around the side of the house, and I see this here lady fighting with a furry-looking varmint.
Turned out it was Ms. Drysdale.
No, Uncle Jed. It was a fox.
Lady was Ms. Drysdale.
Oh, yeah. So I grabs up the shotgun, and I says, "Step aside, lady, and I'll shoot it." Well, instead of that, she whipped around and throwed that thing in the air. Well, I shot it on the fly with both barrels.
Blew my wife's fox fur to shreds.
I wonder if she fainted dead away.
I caught her just in time. The chauffeur had to help me get her into the car. She was out like a light.
She was stewed to the gill. You said it took two men to get her back in the car.
You know, Jethro, could be that there fox was Ms. Drysdale's pet.
Why in tarnation would she want a sneaky old fox for a pet?
Because them kind of people are liable to do anything.
What kind of people?
Ask your paw.
Well, I reckon I can't protect you from the ugly side of life forever. You see, Ms. Drysdale is what city folks calls a... What was her husband called, Granny?
Hypochondriac.
Yeah, that means she drinks a little.
A little? Her own husband said her bedroom was full of bottles.
The doctor says she'll sleep for several hours. He gave her a sedative.
What about Claude?
Oh, she insisted that he have a sedative, too. Poor dog, he's probably the first canine hypochondriac.
Well, let's be thankful for one thing, Mr. Drysdale.
What's that?
The tree outside the window, it completely obscures her view of the Clampett estate.
Yes. And if that tree should ever lose its leaves and she gets one look at those hillbillies...
It shall not happen. The Clampetts have agreed to accompany me to Palm Springs.
Fine, fine. Now, you keep them there until I get Margaret back to Boston.
Can do and will do.
Maybe it's for the best that you know about that poor woman next door, Ellie. Now you can pitch in and help us get her cured.
Yep. I'll need you to help find the makings from a sober nut mash. That's what I'll give her first.
But Miss Jane said she was taking us to Palm Springs.
Folks don't run off and leave the neighbors when he's in trouble. What are you going to need for your sober nut mash, Granny?
Well, most of the stuff I got. But it takes pecan root, wretch weed, sourdough, skunk oil, chimney soot, spider webs, horse mint, snake wort, pepper leaves, chicken gizzards, stump water, coal oil, slippery elm ooze, and turpentine. And a few more things that's secret. Oh, and the biggest toad you can find.
Granny, you use a live toad?
That's just for testing. I give it a swaller to see how fur it jumps.
Last time Granny used a sobering up mash, set a new record. Clean over the top of Elverney Bradshaw's clothesline.
That's tall jumping for a toad.
Oh, this wasn't no toad. This was Elverney's husband, Homer. It was him Granny was sobering up. Well, Ellie, if you're going out in the brush hunting stuff for Granny, you'd best put on some old clothes.
Okay, Pop. Bill, let's get it going. Oh, I pert near forgot. I have to have some goat's milk. After Mrs. Drysdale takes my sobering up mash, she has to have fresh goat's milk every half hour to stop the burning.
Well, I reckon Jethro can borrow some. Well-to-do neighborhood like this, folks is bound to keep goats.
Everybody except us. We ain't even got a cow.
Nor pigs neither.
Nor chickens.
We ain't even got nothing to pull a plow.
You're supposed to be so dad blame rich. I'll bet we're the only family in Beverly Hills that ain't got a mule.
I reckon it is high time I was stocking this place. Even Mr. Drysdale's been after me to buy some cattle.
Well, good for him.
Yeah, just the other day he says, Mr. Clampett, you got $25 million in cash. You ought to put some of that money into stock.
Well, we better get busy now if we're going to find...
There goes that music again. Pedro, did you ever find out where that's coming from?
No, sir, I didn't. Every time I went to looking for it, somebody always come to the door. This time I'm gonna find it for sure.
Yeah, good hunting. Me and Granny will be figuring out what stock to buy.
Doggone it, never fails. Howdy, Miss Hathaway.
Oh, please stop calling me Miss Hathaway. Now, if I can call you by your first name, Jethro, surely you can do the same for me.
But,
please?
Well, howdy, Miss Jethro.
How about calling me Jane?
I like that better.
Well, are we all set to leave for Palm Springs?
No, ma'am. Uncle Jed and me's going to town and buy some stock.
Stock?
Yes, ma'am. Mr. Drysdale, he told Uncle Jed he had ought to put some of his money into stock.
He dictated a memo on that. But you needn't waste time driving into town. You can order your stock by telephone. Now, here are Mr. Drysdale's recommendations. He doesn't want your Uncle Jed to get a bum steer.
Oh, Uncle Jed, he wouldn't buy no bum steer.
He has to be cautious in the bull market.
You gotta be careful with cows, too.
Jethro, you have the most delightfully bucolic sense of humor. Now then, would you like to ride to Palm Springs with me, or would you prefer to drive and meet me there? Jethro?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Would you like to drive your own car?
Oh, yes, ma'am. I like to drive.
Very well. I have typed out explicit directions. I've even drawn a map showing the exact location of the hotel. They have a lovely pool, and... Jethro?
Yes, ma'am?
I'm taking a bikini to Palm Springs.
Is that faster than a train?
Jethro, you dear naive boy. You shall see when we go swimming. You Tarzan. Me Jane.
No, ma'am. I'm Jethro Bodine.
I almost hate to see you change.
I ain't gonna change.
Oh, yes, you will. Under my tutelage, you will become an educated man of letters. Someday, I shall introduce you as... Jethro Bodine. B.A. M.A. Ph.D.
Awful smart woman, but that ain't the way you spell Bodine. All I know is this is the kind of stock Mr. Drysdale thinks is good.
What does that say?
IBM.
What does that spell?
IBM.
What's an IBM?
I don't know. Next it's got USS.
USS?
Well, that's what's wrote there. USS.
That makes sense.
Well, maybe it ain't Mr. Drysdale's fault. Just between you and me, that Miss Hathaway can't spell for sour grapes.
I don't need this list no how. Me and Granny's already figured out what we want.
That's right. A pair of goats, three pigs, four cows, a bull, a mule, and a dozen chickens.
Reckon we get all that on a truck?
Don't have to. Miss Hathaway says just call on the telephone and they bring them out.
Oh, now ain't that nice. Hello?
Jed. I watch that banker feller. You have to stick your finger in them holes and spin her a while.
All right. Reckon that ought to do it.
Operator.
Oh, howdy, ma'am. This here is Jed Clampett. I'd like to buy some stock.
What number do you wish?
Number? A couple of goats, three pigs, four cows, a bull, a mule, and a dozen chickens.
I'll give you information.
Well, thank you, ma'am. I appreciate all the information you can give me. It's the first time I ever bought stock on the telephone.
Perhaps I'd better connect you with a supervisor.
Two heads is better than one.
Supervisor speaking. May I help you?
Well, thank you, ma'am. This here is Jed Clampett, and I'd like to buy some stock.
Do you know the number you wish to reach?
Well, that's more or less up to the animals, but the number I want to start with is a couple of goats, three pigs, four cows, a bull, a mule, and a dozen chickens.
Jethro,
as soon as Billie gets back from the Drysdale, she can milk this here goat.
Mr. Drysdale sure has got a nice house, ain't he, Granny?
Yep. Nice house, nice car, nice job. But the evil of drink has sure laid a heavy hand on his heart. Never forget, Ellie, drinking is a curse.
Do you take a drink now and then, Granny?
Never more than a thimbleful. Oh, Ellie, you might have to hold Mrs. Drysdale while I spoon a sobering up mash down her.
I'll throw a double scissors and an arm lock on her.
Just so you don't cut off her wind, because she can't breathe.
Yes?
Howdy. We've come to see Miss Drysdale.
I'm sorry, madam, but Mrs. Drysdale cannot be disturbed.
Are you her kin?
I'm a butler.
Oh, that must have been her maiden name. You're taking care of her, are you?
I am a butler, madam.
Well, I'm glad to see that her family ain't ashamed to help her.
Whom shall I say called?
Well, this here's Granny, and I'm Ellie Mae. Pa and Jethro would have come too, but they're busy with the cattle.
Very good.
Hold on now. We've come to see Miss Drysdale.
Mrs. Drysdale is indisposed, madam. She is not receiving.
Oh. Still sleeping it off, huh?
Well, when she comes to, you just spoon half of this downer and then stand back.
Yes, she'll commence to doing some tall jumping.
Don't bite you. We'll be back later with the goat's milk.
Want me to stay and help you do for Miss Drysdale?
We are managing, thank you.
Are you doing the washing and the cleaning and the cooking for her?
Certainly not.
Oh, just letting it pile up on her, huh?
Madam, I am a butler.
Want me to haul him out of there, Granny, and wrestle him down?
Kin folks have certain rights. Family comes first.
He sure is proud of that family name, ain't he?
Yeah. To hear him talk, the butlers don't get wet when it rains.
Did you say something, dear? Well, speak up, dear. Can I get you something? Come in.
I beg your pardon, sir. The butler said some people from a ranch brought this for madame.
From a ranch?
Well, he said they mentioned cattle. They called themselves Granny and Ellie May.
The Clampets, they haven't gone to Palm Springs.
Get him in through that gate. That's the way. Suey, pig, pig. Get in there, pig. Come on. Pig. That's the way.
Suey. Oh, no, surely not. Marie, tell me I'm hearing things.
You're hearing things, sir. Cows, chickens, pigs, goats.
No.
Anything I can do, sir?
Pray, Marie. Pray.
Hold your horses. I'm coming.
Oh, howdy, Mr. Drysdale. Did your wife
take Ellie May? Where's your father?
He's tending the cattle.
He brought cattle into this beautiful estate?
No, he called on the telephone, and some men brought him in a truck. Yes, sir. I'm just fixing to go milk the goat. Come on out the stock pen.
Stock pen?
Yes, sir, Mr. Drysdale. I finally took your advice and put some of my money in stock.
How's that goat milk, Ellie?
Just fine, Pop.
This sure is a dandy pen, Mr. Drysdale.
Yeah, good stout fence around outside. Of course, that one across the middle ain't so much. The bull's already jumped it twice and ain't even mating season.
Hey.
Drysdale's some mighty fine-looking stock. Of course, they need a little fattening up.
Mr. Drysdale happy to see him?
Granny, he was so happy he couldn't talk. He just kind of hung on a fence and made little gurgling noises in his throat.
Well, that poor man has some joy coming to him.
I'm glad to be able to help him to forget his trouble for a spell.
Here's the goat's milk, Granny.
Oh, good, Ellie. Now, you run that right over to Mrs. Drysdale. That sobering up mare smarts considerable unless you follow it up with fresh goat's milk.
Ellie, Mr. Drysdale ever find his tongue?
Yeah, Pa. Whilst I was milking the goat, I heard him kind of mumbling like he was giving thanks. He says, oh, what have I done to deserve this?
Lord love me. Ain't that pitiful? Oh, hurry, child, now hurry.
You know, Granny, it gives a person a mighty good feeling to help a neighbor.
You betcha. And he needs us, because his wife's kin ain't no help.
Who's that?
That high and mighty Mr. Butler. That's who came to the door when Ellie and me took the mash over. Wouldn't let us see Miss Drysdale.
Well, now you can't hardly blame him for not wanting folks to see it.
Uncle Jed, the bull jumped that little fence again, so I tied him back over on his side.
Where's Mr. Drysdale? I asked him to come in for some coffee.
It was the funniest thing what happened to him. You know how he was hanging on the fence of the stock pen? Kind of gurgling and mumbling, happy-like?
Yeah.
Well, all of a sudden, he points up towards his house and says, my wife, that's her window. Then he goes tearing off into the bushes like a bear was after him.
She took some mash and he seen her jumping.
Looks like Ellie is going to get there with the goat's milk just in time.
Oh. Oh, Sonny. Sonny, your mumsy just had the most ghastly dream. I was going to see our new neighbors, the Clampetts, and suddenly this dreadful giant appeared with a huge gun and shot my beautiful fox fur. Isn't that the most dreadful? Claude, what are you eating?
Oh, did Ravenswood bring my darling boy some nice fishy scraps?
Claude!
Marie, come and get Claude!
What's the matter, dear?
Claude, he's having a seizure or something.
Is something wrong?
Yes, Marie, open the window.
Yes, let's have some fresh air. No. You just take Claude to the doctor. I'll get the window. Well, darling, how do you feel?
Dreadful. My nerves are shattered. Open the window, dear.
Well, it might not be good for you, Margaret.
Oh, don't be silly, Milburn. I need oxygen. Besides, I adore the fragrance of that jasmine that grows on the fence of that tennis court next door. Now, open the window.
All right, dear, but first I have a surprise.
Surprise? Hmm?
Don't move. I'll be right back.
Granny, that there butler fellow wouldn't let me through that door again. And he wouldn't take this milk, neither.
Why not?
He said he wouldn't touch nothing more from us without it was sterilized.
What's sterilized?
Oh, we had that in school once. That means soaked in alcohol.
Alcohol?
Appears to me like Mr. Drysdale's got two drinkers on his hands.
Mr. Drysdale must be in terrible shape. Fighting me. Scratching and clawing people and everything.
How do you know?
I hear her yelling and screaming clean from upstairs. She says, Marie, come and get Claude. Sure enough, pretty soon, this poor girl come a running down yelling, take me to the doctor, I got Claude.
Family or no family, that woman needs help and by thunder, she's gonna get it.
Surprise.
Milburn, have you taken leave of your senses? You know I'm much too nervous to watch television.
But, darling, the doctors in Boston said your nerves were just fine.
Those Boston doctors. They had the audacity to tell me that I was perfectly healthy. I said, I'm not paying you all that money to tell me I'm healthy. Milburn, I do not want to watch television.
Well, you don't have to watch it, dear. Just listen. There's an exciting Western on.
Western? Milburn, shut that off and open the window.
I will. Oh, there we are.
Are you going to open the window, or am I?
I am, dear. There, you see, the cattlemen and the sheepmen are fighting it out.
Well, if you won't turn it off, I will.
Oh, dear, I do admit that's a very old plot, but I'm sure we can get something better.
That medical program, go back to that.
Well, don't you think that's a bit depressing?
I want the medical program.
All right.
I still hear the cattle and the goats.
Yes, you see, this is the latest thing in television program. A medical western.
A medical western?
Yes, I think it's called Sagebrush Surgeon. That's the window he pointed to right there.
I've got to get some fresh goat's milk up to that woman some way.
I could shinny up the tree and climb right in that window.
Oh, Jethro, it ain't fitting for a man to be in a woman's bedroom.
How about me? No, Ellie. You're too young to handle somebody a-wrestling in the grip of old John Barleycorn. I gotta get up there and have a goat handy to milk ever so often.
I think I got it figured out, Granny.
What?
I'll get a rope, throw it over that limb, hoist you up to the window. Jethro, you get that Mr. Butler away from the front door. And then, Ellie, you take the nanny goat, lead it upstairs to her room for Granny.
All right, Pa. But that little goat ain't gonna do nothing unless it's got that little chicken sitting on his back.
That's all right. Raw egg ain't going to do Ms. Drysdale a bit of harm.
Immediately.
Oh, don't leave me. I love you.
I love you too, Milburn. Why don't you come to Boston with me? You haven't seen Sonny for a long time.
I don't understand. Why have you suddenly decided to go back to Boston?
To see those doctors. Let them dare to tell me now I don't have a nervous condition. I'm even having hallucinations. It's wonderful.
Hallucinations?
I just saw a witch fly by that window, and there's a goat in the bathtub with a chicken riding on its back. Oh, you couldn't see them, dear. Only someone with my shattered nervous system. There goes the witch again. Oh, Milburn, I'm the happiest woman in the world. It's marvelous. Wait until those doctors hear this.
Can't get in the attic and she won't open the window. Heist me up again.
Here, Milburn. Let's have a vitamin toast to my coming triumph.
It's too late, Jed.
What do you mean, Granny?
We didn't get to her in time. Now she's got her husband on the stuff.
Come ride the little train that is rolling down the tracks to the junction. Forget about your cares, it is time to relax at the junction. Lots of curves, you bet, and even more when you get to the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
There's a little hotel called the Shady Rest at the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
It is run by Kate. Come and be her guest at the Junction.
Petticoat Junction.
And that's Uncle Joe. He's a moving kind of slow at the Junction. Petticoat Junction.
Decorations and get busy. Where's Uncle Joe?
In the dining room, Mom.
Oh. Uncle Joe, you promised to hang that sign out front for us.
Kate, I've only got two hands and one mouth.
Well, I guess the girls and I can manage it.
How about a little help from your hobo friend?
Who?
That no good moocher that's taking you for free room and board.
I presume you're referring to Mr. Norman Curtis.
I'm referring to Nutty Norman, the freeloader.
Uncle Joe, Mr. Curtis may be temporarily financially embarrassed, but he is an ambitious, intelligent, refined, well-educated gentleman.
Don't waste all that hot air. Put it in here.
You're going to be sorry when you find out where he is right now.
In the kitchen, eating up all the food?
No, sir. He's gone to Pixley with Floyd and Charlie. He's got a plan to attach a flat car to the back of the train, put benches on it, and bring 50 extra people to our jamboree.
Now, where would he get a flat car?
He says he has connections with the railroad.
His only connections are with a knife and fork.
Well, Floyd and Charlie thought enough of his plan to take him into Pixley with them. In fact, they gave him the throttle.
That's dangerous.
Why?
He might put ketchup on it and eat it.
He sure looks happy, don't he?
Of course he does. Poor old hobo, all of his life he's been riding the rods, and now he's at the throttle of the Hooterville Cannonball.
Hey, Norman.
Yeah?
You really think you can get that flat car?
Well, I told you fellas, I got connections with this railroad.
Mr. Curtis' office. No, I'm sorry. Mr. Curtis is out of the city for a few days. Secretary of Labor? Yes, I'll tell him. Mr. Curtis' office? No, I'm sorry. He won't be able to go to Washington for the White House conference. Mr. Curtis' office? No, I'm sorry. He's someplace between Hooterville and Pixley. I don't know where they are either.
Fellas, Uncle Joe and I'll watch from the sidelines.
Well, speak for yourself, Kate. I can shake a foot with any of these young bucks.
Come on, Uncle Joe.
Oh, come on.
Look, two more fellas.
Now we've all got partners.
Come on, Charlie, we'll show you a new dance with the jamboree.
Hold it, girls. I'm afraid there ain't going to be a jamboree.
Oh, no,
what are you talking about?
There's no way for the folks to get here. That fella Curtis has wrecked the cannonball.
Wrecked the cannonball?
What?
He just as good as wrecked it. Busted the throttle right smack off.
Can't run a train without a throttle.
How'd it happen?
He tried to show off going up Bleecker's Hill.
Yanked the throttle back so hard he snapped it right in two.
Pulled a rod right out of the baller.
Yeah, Floyd and I had to pound it back with a block of wood. Shut off the steam.
Well, what'd you do, walk all the way from Bleecker's Hill?
No, we let it roll backwards and coasted to here.
Well, Kate, what do you think of your refined, intelligent Mr. Curtis now? He's wrecked the train and ruined our jamboree. I hope you're satisfied.
Shh, here he comes.
Ha 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 ha!
just stand there, Kate. Go get him something to eat. He's probably hungry after all he did today.
I don't know what to say.
Take a crack at goodbye.
Joe. Charlie, can't the throttle be fixed?
I'm afraid we'd have to get a new one.
A new old one? They ain't made them like that in 50 years.
Might as well face it, Kate, that Cannonball can't be fixed in time to bring the folks to the jamboree.
Yes, it can. Now, listen to me, everyone.
Quiet, folks. We're going to hear some words of wisdom from our distinguished hobo guest.
I hadn't intended to reveal my identity to you, but now I think I should. And then you'll know that I can have the train fixed. I am Norman P. Curtis, president of the CNFW Railroad.
Are you sure that throttle can't be fixed?
Don't you believe me?
Norman, this is no time for jokes.
But wait a minute, Kate. I'll prove it to you. Anybody got a dime?
Oh, forget it, Norman. That thing's as phony as you are.
What?
It's got the same kind of connections with the telephone company you got with the railroad. None.
Well, why is it here?
Gives the hotel class, which it's gonna need plenty of with you here. Norman, you're pathetic.
Maybe Lon Hocker can fix that.
He's a farmer.
He also does blacksmithing. If he can mend a plow, why can't he forge that together?
Well, how are we gonna get up to his place with no train?
Cut through the woods to the county road and hitch a ride.
Let's go, Charlie. It's worth a try.
I just wanted to say I'm awful sorry about Mr. Curtis. Kind of feel like it's my fault for inviting him to stay here.
Oh, Kate, don't be blaming yourself.
It's our fault, too. We let him drive the train.
Kate, I'm kind of worried about Floyd and me going off and leaving you and the girls and Nutty Norman.
But Uncle Joe's here.
Well, that's what I mean. Can you handle two of them?
Get out of here, both of them.
Kate. If I can only get to a telephone, I guarantee you I can have that train running again.
Well, the nearest telephone is in Hooterville.
Well, isn't there any way I can get there?
There's a hand car down by the water tower, but that's a mighty long way to pump.
Well, I was the stroke on the Yale varsity crew that beat Harvard, Princeton, and Cornell. Yeah.
I liked him so much better before he started all that bragging.
What's the matter? You girls haven't touched a bite of your food.
Not hungry.
Me either.
Uncle Joe, how can you eat at a time like this?
Well, this is a perfect time. When Nutty Norman's at the table, nobody else had a chance.
What do you girls expect to do any dancing when you're not eating?
Who's going to be dancing?
Now no one can get here for the jamboree.
Oh, no, let's not give up. We got a lot of things going for us. Maybe Lon Hocker will forge the throttle back together again. Maybe Nutty Norman will... I mean, Mr. Curtis will do something.
Please, and... Kate, not while I'm eating.
Well, he's certainly trying. He's pumping the hand car all the way to Hooterville.
Oh, fine. It's not enough losing the train. Now the hand car is gone.
Well, come on, girls. If you're not going to eat, pick up your plates, take them to the kitchen and help me. And don't pay any attention to your Uncle Joe about anything he says about Mr. Curtis. I still say, in spite of everything that's happened, that man has something great inside him.
Yeah, our food.
Good afternoon, ladies.
How do you do? Oh, we're waiting for the train.
Well, I wish you luck.
Pardon me. Would one of you ladies please let me have a dime? It's very important. Thank you very much. Hello, operator. I want to talk person to person to General Frank Newton. And the number is code area 311-555-8324. And I want extension 1111. Operator, charges to credit account 555-2368L-184. Well, I just gave you the number. Code area 311-555-8324. Extension 1111. Credit account is 555-2368L-184. Oh, this number. Well, why didn't you say so? Hooterville 3. Oh, hello, Frank. This is Norman. Well, how's my favorite general? You old rascal, you've been fooling around with models long enough. How would you like to work on the real thing? Well, of course it's important. I wouldn't ask you otherwise. And Frank, some wonderful people are depending on it. Now listen, I want you to get a hold of George Prentice in Detroit and Dave LaSalle in New York, and I want all of you here in Hooterville the first thing in the morning ready to go to work. Hooterville. Well, get out your map and your magnifying glass, and I'll tell you where it is.
Is he? That's the hobo Kate Bradley took in. They call him a Nutty Norman.
Say one thing. You might as well say goodbye to your dime.
You're very nice.
Train. Just because she sat here since yesterday doesn't mean she won't run again.
Anybody showed up yet?
Well, not yet, but the girls are out looking.
Might as well take that stupid sign down. We ain't gonna have no jamboree.
Uncle Joe, whatever you do, don't start acting gloomy and pessimistic in front of the girls. We gotta keep their spirits up.
Okay.
Mother!
Any sign of the hand car coming from Hooterville?
No, Mother. And it would just break your heart to see the poor old cannonball. Chickens are laying eggs in her, and goats are chewing on her. It's terrible.
Oh, baby, cheer up. Everything's going to be fine. Isn't it, Uncle Joe?
Oh, you bet. Just fine and dandy.
Yeah.
Mom!
Oh, any sign of Floyd and Charlie?
Not a sign, Mother. We hike clear over to the county road.
Well, now, don't get discouraged. Everything's going to be fine. Isn't it, Uncle Joe?
You bet. Just fine and dandy.
What are you doing?
I'm going to take this stupid sign down. We ain't going to have no jamboree.
Down off of there.
Norman. Norman, jar that loose. Kate.
What's the matter?
That freeloader, not a Norman. He's back, and he brung his rat pack with him.
Rat pack?
Three more freeloaders. Hobos just like him. And this time, they're going to finish the cannonball for sure.
What do you mean?
They're swarming all over it, taking it apart. They're probably going to cart it up and haul it away and sell it for junk. Kate, I wouldn't go down there if I was you. They look dangerous.
Oh, I'll be all right.
Well, yell if you need me. I'll be having a bite of lunch.
Frank, communication setups ready to go.
Be with you in a minute.
Norm, the valve rod is shot. What do you suppose kept her going?
Habit. Well, I guess we'd better put another one in, huh?
Norman.
Hello, Kate.
Well, good heavens, what are you doing to the train?
We're getting it ready for the jamboree. That's what you wanted, wasn't it?
Well, I declare you brought in a whole repair crew.
Yeah, well, you never saw a crew like this before.
Oh, they look very
experienced.
Gentlemen, this is Mrs. Bradley, the little lady I told you about. Kate, I want you to meet General Frank Newton.
How do you do, ma'am?
General.
Retired, ma'am. Yes, all he does now is serve as chairman of the board of the Michigan and Southwest Railroad.
Goodness.
And this is George Prentice. He's president of Worldwide Airways.
Ma'am, Newt, let me have the wrench.
And the fellow up in the baggage car is Dave LaSalle. Hey, Dave! He's president of Intercontinental Telephone.
Well, they're certainly a mighty distinguished group.
Kate, the boys have come a long way, and, well, they're working pretty hard. I don't suppose you could scare up a little...
Food. Yeah, well, of course I can. Just give me 15 minutes, and then bring your group up to the dining room.
Okay, go ahead.
Hello, Peterson? Peterson? Frank Newton. Now, listen. I want the throttle lever off the Emma Sweeney. That's the wood burner in the north wing. Right.
Mighty handy having your own railroad museum, isn't it?
Dave, call my office. I'll have a plane pick it up.
What good will that do? You can't land a jet around here.
They still make parachutes. They can drop it right down the smokestack.
Hey, Peterson! Peterson, put that throttle lever in a metal drop crate and rush it out of the airport. Worldwide Airlines will pick it up.
Dave, get me my office.
Just a minute, Norman. Dave, put me through to my office first.
Okay. Operator, connect me with the main office of Worldwide Airlines. And don't give me that busy circuit routine. You can clear to Chicago, Denver, New Orleans. It doesn't matter, but put it through. My own company, and I can't get a line.
They're all just like Norman. Nuttier than fruitcakes.
By the way, Frank, did you take advantage of the market tip I gave you on Western Mining?
Yeah, bought 10,000 shares. Dropped 6 points in a week.
Don't blame me. I got the tip from my secretary.
You've just got the wrong girl. Mine steered me into General Products, and I made almost $250,000 in 3 weeks.
Now, that's the secretary.
Not only that, she's learning to type.
With all your money, what are you going to do with another $250,000?
I think I'll buy a locomotive like the Hooterville Cannonball. Put it in the backyard and work on it weekends. I haven't had so much fun in years.
How about it, Norman? Do you want to sell the Hooterville Cannonball?
Sorry, boy. She's not for sale.
Oh. Squirrel would have a feast in there.
Kate, we got to get them hobos out of here as quick as we can. They're plumb raving loony. You ought to hear them talking about the money they got.
Oh, Uncle Joe, when men are down on their luck, they're bound to exaggerate a little. It makes them feel better.
Yeah, well, come listen to the guff they're spouting. It's plumb crazy.
Norman, this is magnificent. Why, it's even better than we used to get at the officers' clubs.
Well, I wouldn't know about that, General. I was an enlisted man myself.
I've eaten all over the world, France, Italy, the Orient, the finest ocean liners. But this is the best, the most delicious food I've ever eaten.
No wonder you're so fond of this place, Norman. Well, it isn't only the food. There's also Kate.
Oh, yeah. Ah, I see what you mean. I don't blame you.
Mighty attractive woman.
Oh, no.
I don't think they're talking so crazy.
Kate, we got it.
Well, our hawker came through.
Just like new.
Oh, that's wonderful, boys. Take her down and put her right on.
Oh, please, Kate, feed us first. We're starving.
I'll clear out all the freeloaders.
Hurry up, fellas. Now, that jet'll be through here with us.
Oh, no!
Mr. Curtis, what have you got against our train?
That was a beautiful drop.
With that wind drift, it ought to land right in our lap.
When I run an airline, I run an airline.
Look, Mom, it's falling right down by the tracks.
I wonder what it could be.
Well, whatever it is, it's for them. They're running after it.
Kate?
I was wrong about those men, and I'm big enough to admit it. They ain't hobos. They're spies.
By golly, Norman, I believe she's as good as ever.
She's better than ever. We fixed things on there you didn't even know about.
Sure. They've been riding the rails so long, they're experts.
Let her roll, boys. We're going to have a jamboree after all.
What do you mean I could use Phoebe for my secretary?
Well, she'll give you some real hot tips on the market. Listen, Phoebe, what'll General Products come and do on the market next week?
Going up.
Hello, Lydia. Daddy, come.
Well, hello. Welcome to Shady Rest. Welcome to Shady Rest.
Oh, Uncle Joe, this is going to be the best jamboree yet. And I didn't even think it was going to come off.
Me neither. Boy, what a jinx that nutty Norman turned out to be.
What do you mean? Well, he was responsible for fixing the train.
Well, that's the least he could have done. Nothing ever happened to it until he came. I tell you, Kate, the man's a jinx.
I thought you said he was a spy.
Well, that's the worst kind. Hi, Charlie.
Hello, Charlie. Hello, Floyd. What happened to your hand?
Firebox door bit me.
Darn thing ain't worked in 20 years, and them fellas had to come along and put a spring in.
Huh? But Floyd's the only one can double on fiddle. Oh, how can you have a jamboree without a fiddler?
That's easy. You don't.
Sorry, folks.
Like I said, Kate, that feller's a jinx.
Watch it, Joe. Here he comes.
Yeah, let's go, Kate. The boys haven't been to a jamboree in years. They're champing at the bit.
Well, they're not going to need a harness tonight.
What do you mean?
You had to go fix the firebox door.
Yeah, you wrecked his fiddling hand. That's what you did. Now, let's see you fix that.
Well, that's the easiest thing in the world. Come on, Floyd. Ow!
Yeah, he'll fix it all right. He'll probably wreck the other hand. The jinx.
If it hadn't been for Norman Curtis. Don't you think it's about time you admitted you were wrong?
Oh, I guess so. But how was I to know he could play the fiddle?
Mrs. Bradley, may I have the honor of this dance?
With pleasure, General.
General.
Come on, Joe. Don't be a wallflower.
This has been a Filmways presentation.
Never in all my born days.
How'd an old mountain goat like me ever get a youngin' like you? You're a queen.
That's what you are in that shiny dress standing there. You're a queen.
Feel it, Paul. It's slicker than a toad's belly.
I'll get if it ain't. What kind of dress they call that?
Well, this is what you call a ball gown.
A ball gown? Well, you're even catching on to what they named.
Well, Miss Hathaway, she pinned a piece of paper onto every dress she got me. I tell him what it was for.
You better tote along the shotgun and keep fellas away.
Oh, no, Paul. That's what I'm going out for, to meet some fellas.
Hallelujah. You know, you're going to find out something I've been saying is the truth. You don't have to dress up in boys' clothes to have fun with boys.
I'm going to keep my promise, Paul. I ain't going to wear nothing but dresses for 3 whole days.
And I'm going to keep my promise, too. If you don't have just as much fun as you did climbing trees and wrestling, you can go back to wearing your pants and shirt.
Goodbye, Pop.
What you doing? Killing ants?
Hey, this place ain't got no ants.
I'll tell you something else it ain't got. That's me. I'm gonna pack up and go home.
Now wait a minute. Hold on there. This is home.
Not to me it ain't. And for my part, they can give Beverly Hills back to the Indians. Or whoever else was fool enough to come here in the first place.
Come on, let's go in here and sit down and we'll talk this whole thing over. You just got your back up because the police made us get rid of all our cows and pigs and chickens and stuff.
Well, that didn't help, hon. But if they don't allow folks to have a stock, why have they got that all-fired fancy stock pen down there?
Well, Granny, it turned out that there was something called a tennis court.
What in tarnation is a tennis?
I don't know, but one of these days we'll get us a pair of them and go to raise them out there.
Well, you go to raising them. I'm going back home, where I can get some good things in life, like hog jowls and possum shank.
Now, hold on, Granny. Jethro's out hunting possums right now.
Well, he won't find none. I've been all over these Beverly Hills, and I tell you it ain't easy. Climbing fences and walls and jumping over hedges to get around those cement ponds where there are a lot of half-naked women laying there smearing themselves with oil and yelling at you to get out, get out. I tell you, Jed, this place is full of the laziest, greasiest, unfriendliest mess of people I ever did lay my eyes on.
Here's Jethro. Hi, boy. What'd you get?
I got chased by a fellow with a club.
Now, you hear that, Jed? It says Beverly Hillbillies picking on a little boy like Jethro. Come on, Jethro, load up the truck and let's head for home.
Ah, hold on. I think I know what's ailing you two. You're just plain old homesick.
Well, I'm sick of this home, I can tell you that.
Yeah, now, I got a surprise I've been kind of saving. I reckon now as good time as any to let the cat out of the bag.
We need pigs and chickens, and he gets us a cat.
Now, that ain't the surprise, Granny. The surprise is Pearl's coming out here.
Ma's coming out here?
Yeah, and she's bringing your sister, Jethreen.
Hot diggity dog.
Yeah, I wrote her a letter. I said, Pearl, I says, why don't you come out here and bring Jethreen? We got lots of room and plenty to eat, and we sure is a hanker to see you.
Oh, boy. I gotta get us some possum now, because if there's one thing Ma and Jethreen likes, it's grits and possum shanks.
You don't look particular cheered up, Granny.
Jed, you might fool that boy with a story like that, but not me.
What do you mean?
Since when can you write letters?
Wait a minute, Granny. Granny, I didn't write that letter by hand.
Held the pencil twixt your toes, did you?
No, I wrote it by a new way. The banker's secretary showed me. It's called dictation.
What's dictation?
Well, it's wonderful, Granny. You just talk and she writes it down.
She sure must write fast.
Yeah, with a bad hand, too.
She got a bad hand?
This one, she calls it her shorthand.
I don't care how many letters you dictate, Jed. Pearl ain't a-coming out here. Leastwise, not right now.
Well, sure she is, Granny. She's looking to find a husband for Jethreen.
I'll tell you who Pearl is a-looking to get a husband for. Pearl. And I think she's got her cap set for that oil man that bought your swamp.
Mr. Brewster? Why, he lives clean over to Tulsa.
Yeah, but pumping oil brings him over to your place. And I'll bet you pigs to polecats that when he shows up, Pearl ain't fur behind.
Fancy meeting you here. Small world, ain't it?
Yes, it certainly is.
Oh, this here's my daughter, Jethreen. This is Mr. Brewster, dear.
I'm pleased to meet you, young lady.
Hi.
May I give you a hand, Mrs. Bodine?
Oh, thank you. You stay in the buggy, dear.
Careful now. There we are. Well, I see you girls are on your way to a Halloween party.
What kind of party?
Halloween.
What's a Halloween?
You don't celebrate Halloween here in the hills?
Well, I never heard of it. What's it like?
Well, it's an occasion where everyone gets dressed up in their most beautiful clothes.
Oh, these old things, they're just something I threw together myself.
Well, they look like they came from Saks.
Well, they didn't. I made them with store-bought yard goods. Didn't I, Jethreen?
Yes, sir.
What brings you girls here on this beautiful Indian summer day?
Following you.
we was headed this way anyway. I promised to keep an eye on the old home place for Cousin Jed, remember? Mm.
Oh, I hope he won't mind that I had a telephone put in the cabin. You see, we're using it as a sort of a field office.
Oh, he won't mind. Especially if you would show it to me and I could see for myself that there was no damage done to the cabin.
Well, that's quite all right. Come along, huh?
Stay in the buggy, dear.
Well, perhaps you'd like to stretch your legs.
They're long enough now. Jethreen's awful tall for age. She takes after her father. Her late father, that is. I'm a widow.
Yes, I believe you told me.
Oh, that's right. That's when you told me you was a widower.
Yes.
You, still are, I suppose.
A widower? No, yes.
Stay in the buggy, dear.
I'm going back where I should have stayed in the first place.
Now, Granny. Before you do something you're liable to be sorry for, you better take another look around. See all the nice things we got here that you wouldn't have back home.
Like what?
Like this great big cooking room, for one thing. Why, you could take our whole cabin and put it right in this one room.
Well, if you did that, I might stay.
What about them big ice boxes? Ain't got nothing like them back home.
Didn't need them. Got nippy in the fall like the good Lord intended it to. This crazy California stays warm all year round.
Well, that's awful good for growing thing. Look at that fruit there. Did you ever in your whole born days ever see anything as pretty as that fruit? Don't spoil neither.
Don't taste neither.
Oh, now.
Jethro ate a whole bunch of them grapes. Two apples, a pear, and a whole handful of strawberries. And he said there wasn't one bit of juice in the whole kit and caboodle of them. He said it was dry as wax.
His is mighty dry and gummy. Maybe he ain't supposed to eat this fruit.
That's the trouble with this miserable place. You ain't supposed to do nothing. You ain't supposed to have cows or pigs or chickens. You ain't supposed to fire up the still and make a little moonshine whiskey. Answer me. What can you do in this Beverly Hills?
Well, you can do lots of things, Granny. Things you couldn't do back home.
Name one.
Well, you can call up your friends on the telephone.
No, you can't.
Why not?
Because we ain't got no friends, that's why not. There ain't been one neighbor come a-calling on us since we moved in here.
Oh, so that's what's ailing you. Nobody's been coming to call. Well, now you gotta remember what Pearl said. This here is Beverly Hills where the movie stars live.
What's that got to do with it? What's that got to do with being friendly?
Nothing, I just thought it might sidetrack you.
Well, it didn't. Movie stars are people just like us, ain't they?
Yes, certainly prettier. Wouldn't it be worth waiting for if one of these days there come a knock on the door and we go to answer it and we open up the door and standing there would be Mary Pickford.
Mary Pickford?
Yeah, with the golden curls hanging down her back and her pretty little rosebud mouth saying friendly things like, howdy there, I'm Mary Pickford. What would you say to that?
I'd say who's Mary Pickford, that's right.
Granny, she's America's sweetheart. You know that movie house where Pearl plays Pianny on Saturday nights?
I heard of it.
Well, she says little old Mary is everybody's favorite.
Well, tell me this. If Mary Pickford moved in that little cabin down the creek from us back home, what would we do?
Oh, we'd have gone calling and brought her over a mess of pone and skin possum.
Yeah. And has Mary Pickford brought us a mess of pone and skin possum? No, she ain't.
You gotta remember, Granny, she probably spends 4 or 5 hours a day just fooling with and combing that beautiful curl that hangs clear down.
Uncle Jan!
Well, hello, Jethro. What'd you get this time?
I got arrested. Yeah. Policeman, he took my gun away. He said they don't allow hunting in Beverly Hills.
That doesn't. That doesn't.
Then he pointed to old Duke here. He said, that dog had his rabies shot? And I said, no, sir, that dog ain't had nothing shot. I'm careful with a gun.
What'd he say?
He said, oh, a wise guy, huh? So he put Duke and me in his police car. But we jumped out and run.
Oh, is Ma and Jeff Reen here yet?
No, and they ain't a-coming. Now, if you want to see your Ma and your sis, you pack up that truck, and you and me will skedaddle back home where folks is friendly.
Now, Granny. Oh, gone if she ain't the muliest little woman. Granny, now just a minute. Now, Granny, will you just let me say one thing?
Well, you be quick, because I got a long trip ahead of me.
Granny, I know it ain't been easy for you out here. New things is always vexing, especially at your age. But I'm bound and determined to keep this family together. And if you go back to the hills, we's all going with you. Now, I'm asking you please to stay. Not for my sake, but for Ellie Mae. Granny, what this place has done for her is a plain miracle. Why, that wild engine has become a grand lady. I wish you could have seen her go out that door looking like a queen in a picture book. I tell you, I just wanted to sit down and bawl the way you done when I married her ma. Now, she's just... She's out there now. Now, just wait, Granny. Wait till you see. In here, Ellie Mae.
Pop, you sure look right. Well, Huggins, you don't have to wear boys' clothes to have fun with boys.
May, you promised me you wouldn't wrestle.
I ain't been wrestling.
Then what have you been doing in your ball gown?
Doing what I'm supposed to do, playing ball. Oh, I made 2 touchdowns and kicked 3 field goals.
Well, your cousin certainly seems anxious for you to come to Beverly Hills, Mrs. Bodine. Will you? Mrs. Bodine?
Yeah.
Will you?
Yeah. Will I what?
Go to Beverly Hills to visit your cousin, Mr. Clampett.
Oh, well, not right now. I'm awful busy. You see, I do fancy sewing and hat making and give beauty courses and personality building and music lessons.
Then on Saturday, I play the piano over the movie show to Oxford. And then, of course, there are my young ones, Jethro and Jethreen. Of course, they're no trouble. Jethro's in California, and Jethreen, she's fixing to get married.
Well, congratulations. When's the wedding?
Soon as she finds a fella.
Well, you certainly are a busy woman, Mrs. Bodine.
Yeah. As Cousin Jed used to say, Parlite, the fella that gets you sure don't have to worry about supporting you.
This is the phone I was telling you about. It's called a field telephone. Now, with this, I can communicate directly with the men working at the drilling site.
Any young men down there?
No, yes.
Any unmarried young men?
I'm sure there are.
Any tall unmarried young men?
Well, they're probably all sizes.
Yeah. Suppose it gets pretty lonesome working down there.
Well, it's very likely. This is rather an isolated area.
Any specially tall, specially lonesome, unmarried young ones?
I don't think I can call any by name, no.
Uh-huh. Well, I was just wondering.
Excuse me, ma'am. Could you tell me where the oil drillers are working today? Well, now, what have we here? Rebecca of Sunnybrook Farm, and pretty, too. You know what, honey? I got something here just for you. A genuine French garter imported all the way from Paris, France. They usually sell for 50 cents, but, honey, you can have it for a quarter. Listen, honey, I'm gonna be around a couple of days. You busy Saturday night? Well, you are now. And there's a dance over in Hooterville. Ooh-wee! I bet you're an armful of mama. I mean it, honey. I like big girls. You just do things to me. You carry me away.
All right.
Hey, what's going on here?
What are you doing?
I'm figuring. And I figure best when I'm fishing.
Ain't no fish in there.
I ain't fishing for fish. I'm fishing for figuring.
Hey, what kind of figuring you fishing for?
I'm fishing to figure how I can get home.
Now, Granny, I've been doing some figuring, too. And you know, I think I got it figured out how come the neighbors ain't come to visit us.
I'm listening.
Well, we ain't got it figured. Out here in Beverly Hills, instead of them coming to see us, we go to see them.
How come?
Oh, I don't know how come. That's just the way I got it figured.
Mighty convenient figuring.
Granny, it wouldn't do no harm and to give it a try. A lot of things are different out here.
Well, I'll fish on it for a spell. Take possum.
Feed like a whale.
Who said there ain't fish in here?
Well, that's the prettiest I ever seen.
I gotcha, you rascal. I'm gonna throw you right in the frying pan. This thing ain't nothing but skin. That's your Beverly Hills for you. All flashy and show on the outside and nothing on the inside where it counts.
Now, fishing, people, is two different things. We're going to calling on our neighbors, and then we'll do our judging. Well, let's see now. Which neighbor shall we call on first? Mrs. Drysdale's off in Boston with his missus, so let's go this way.
If you ask me, let's go back that way.
Now, Granny, you promise. Come on, everybody, let's go.
You reckon they'll give us a mess of pond or something, Paul?
Or maybe some salted down possum.
Probably so lie on us.
I'm not expecting anyone, Agnes.
Oh, it's probably just them children playing trick-or-treat, ma'am.
Hi, ma'am. We's the Clampetts.
You got something for us?
Yes, bro.
Aren't you rather big for this?
Yes, ma'am, we are. In fact, I don't see how anybody gets through that little door.
Just a minute. Come in. Come in and set a spell, as you folks say up in the hill.
Well, thank you. We got a lot of calls to make. But this here is Granny.
Howdy.
Hello.
I'm a daughter, Ellie.
Oh.
My nephew, Jethro.
Oh.
And I'm Jed.
Hello, Jed. I'm Agnes. Just call me Aggie.
Mighty nice place you got here, Aggie.
Oh, shucks. Tain't nothing but a heap of bricks, but we call it home.
Well, sure is nice to meet up with you.
Oh, well, now, wait just a minute. I got something for you. Wait a second. Here you go, Granny and Ellie. That's you and Jethro. You and Jed. There.
Yeah, thank you. That's mighty neighborly of you. You must come and see us sometime.
Yeah, we'll go hunting together.
Hey, Aggie, you like to play football?
Love it!
Well, there's a whole bunch of fellas that plays in the pasture down the way a piece. And they'd like it just fine if I could bring some more girls along.
I don't think...
Please, can we go out now?
Not yet, children. Not till it gets dark.
Ain't that the most pitiful thing?
Heart-rending. Just heart-rending.
Nice-looking woman. Friendly as you please. But them young'uns is the homeliest I ever see.
Wonder she didn't want to come a-calling on us.
Yeah. Reckon I'd stay home, too, if my kids looked like that.
Kid, I ain't never gonna say a bad word about nobody.
I know what you mean.
Dingies, every house we went to, they was nice to us, wasn't they?
Sure was, Kid.
Hey, listen, everybody. I got an idea. Let's call up Cousin Pearl and tell her to come on out here.
Uncle Jed, you can't call Ma on the telephone.
Well, Mrs. Drysdale said we could call anybody we had in mind to.
Well, Ma, she ain't got no telephone at home.
Don't matter. She ain't never home no how.
The way I look at it, you can't never tell what you can do until you try.
Don't forget to spin the wheel.
Howdy, ma'am. I want to talk to Pearl Bodine back in Oxford.
That's right, operator. J.D. Clampett in Beverly Hills.
Oh, Jed sure gonna be surprised to hear me talking at him on this thing.
Oh, they're ready to make the connection.
Hello! Jed, that you, Jed?
You betcha it is.
Hello, Pearl, you old rascal. What you doing down there?
Hi, Bonnie. Pearl, this here's Ellie.
Jethro talk in a minute, but first I want to say something. You got to come out here to Beverly Hills and bring Jethreen. If she can't get a husband out here, there ain't no hope. You ain't never seen so many homely young'uns in all your born days.
The little train that is rolling down the tracks to the junction. Forget about your cares, it is time to relax at the junction. Lots of curves, you bet, and even more when you get to the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
There's a little hotel called the Shady Rest at the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
It is run by Kate, come and be her guest at the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
And that's Uncle Joe, he's a moving kind of slow at the junction. Petticoat Junction.
Picking up them ties, we won't make the next curve.
Pretty straight from here. Go alone, Charlie. There's something waiting for me in Sam Drucker's store.
Another letter from that Lonely Hearts woman, Camille Tewksbury?
It's more than a letter this time. I sent her my picture. Wearing my store-bought hair.
Now, there's something you can burn. And the quicker, the better.
Come on, kids. Cheer up. Can't win them all.
Well, do we have to lose them all?
Hi, Bettie Jo.
Hi, Mr. Drucker.
I take it Hooterville dropped another one?
63-0.
Well, look on the bright side. It's not as bad as last week.
Thanks anyway, Sam. I guess you heard the score, huh?
Yeah, looks like the team's improving. How'd my boy Herbie Bates do? Did he give a good account of himself?
Maybe you better ask him. Here he comes.
I'm sorry, Mr. Drucker. We lost again.
Oh, now, don't feel too bad, Herbie. It's how you play the game that counts. And from the looks of you, you really gave him a scrap.
I didn't even get off the bench.
Herbie, if you were just warming the bench, how'd all this happen?
The team ran over me on the way to the shower.
They were in a hurry to get off the field. Who can blame them?
Oh, here comes that Hooterville coach. Have I got a few words to say to him?
Now, Sam, take pity on the poor man. His team just lost 63-0.
Last week, it was 72-0.
And the week before that, it was...
Herbie. You were pathetic.
How can you blame Herbie? You didn't even let him play.
No, Sam.
That was my strategy. He was supposed to run up and down the sidelines and keep the Pixie boys worried, wondering when I'd send him in. Instead of that, he worried our boys. They were afraid I would send him in.
Cheer up, Herbie. That's right. You'll get to play next week.
You're the one that's pathetic. Why don't you resign?
You know, Uncle Joe, this might be a good time. You could retire with a perfect record.
A perfect record?
An unbroken string of defeats.
I got news for you Monday morning quarterbacks. We ain't gonna lose next week.
Oh, what makes you think so?
We ain't gonna play.
Train's coming, Mom. Just heard her whistle for the station.
Well, we've got groceries in the back room. Come on, Sam. Come on, Coach.
Ought to resign.
Did the mail come?
Oh, yeah, but I ain't had a chance to sort it yet. It's in a sack back in the storeroom.
Hi, Floyd.
Hi, Floyd.
Hi, Mr. Smooth.
Hi, Floyd.
Hi.
I didn't know Floyd could move that fast. Wonder if I could get by using him in the Hooterville backfield.
Come on, Uncle Joe.
Yeah, we better not stay here too long. You know, there's an angry mob foreman when I left the football field.
Let's get into Floyd.
Shoulder pads come in real handy. I might have you wear those all the time. afraid Floyd's got himself woman trouble.
Floyd Smoot?
That darn fool jumped down out of the cab before I could stop the train. He's gonna kill himself over that woman.
What woman? What woman?
Camille Tewksbury.
Camille Tewksbury. She must be new in town.
Well, she's not local, Kate. She's one of them mail order sweethearts.
Floyd met her through the Lonely Hearts column of a magazine.
Oh, well, there's nothing wrong with that. What does she look like?
Nobody knows, including Floyd.
But Floyd sent Camille his picture, and today he figures he'll get sent her picture, and that's why he's back there rooting through the mail sack.
Well, I hope for Floyd's sake she's nice looking.
Come on, let's get that train rolling. Bad as it is, better than riding out of town on one rail.
Yeah, but Uncle Joe, I want to... Well, I'll see Floyd on the train.
Floyd, come on, let's get rolling.
Got your letter from Camille, huh?
Yeah.
Let's see her picture, Floyd. Oh, you got yourself a dog, huh? I warned you. Coming, Bettie Jo. Next time you listen to me.
Floyd, don't pay any attention to him. The worst mistake a man can make is to marry a beautiful woman. They're nothing but trouble. You remember that?
Yeah.
No, I'm serious, Floyd. The plain ones make the best wives. In fact, the homelier, the better.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, Floyd. Now, she can't be that bad. Holy smoke. She is. That looks like a man wearing a wig.
It is.
What?
That's my picture. She sent it back.
Oh, Floyd, listen. Wait a minute.
Bettie Jo, I'll bet you're the only kid in the country that drives a train home from school.
Charlie, what could have happened to Floyd? Usually he's up here every 5 minutes checking on us.
Love life got derailed. But he'll get over it.
Who's he in love with?
Well, he's been writing letters to some woman, Camille Tewksbury. But they exchanged pictures, and that ended that.
Gee, I hope he isn't taking it too hard.
Oh, don't worry about it, honey. Your ma and Sam Drucker's back there with him. They'll switch him back on the track.
Floyd, come on now. Unlock this door.
Go away. Leave me alone.
Now, that's no use, Kate. He's just going to sit out there and pine over Camille Tewksbury.
Sam, let me try something. Floyd Smoot, I got a bone to pick with you. Now you unlock that door, or I'm climbing out this window. All right?
No, no, hey, don't do that. I'll open the door.
You traitor, you double-crosser, you love pirate. So we're not good enough for you, huh?
Hoo-hoo-hoo.
The women in this valley, that's hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo. All these years you've been leading us on. Keeping us dangling on a string, playing fast and loose with our hearts.
Me?
Yes, you. And now that you've reached your prime and we're all wondering who's going to be the lucky woman, you turn your back on us and you take up with an out-of-towner. You're nothing but a typical playboy bachelor, Floyd Smoot.
Me?
Oh, don't act innocent with me. I've heard all about you and that Camille Tewksbury. But let me tell you something. At the next church social, there isn't a woman in this valley that'll sell you a cake or a boxed lunch. We've given you the best years of our lives. Now you're tossing us aside like a bunch of old shoes.
Me?
No, I'm just not going to cry, because you're not worthy of my tears.
Hey, listen, Kate, I don't understand. Kate, open the door. I want to talk to you.
No, sir. You stay out there and cool your hot blood, you fickle Casanova, you.
Me? Me?
Me?
actually managed to squeeze by us.
63-0.
My boys weren't able to execute the plays I gave them. They need more skull practice. Pixley was sharp, well-organized, well-trained.
Uncle Joe, Pixley hasn't even got a coach.
And neither has Hooterville.
Pixley hasn't got a coach? Maybe we could protest the game on that basis.
Huh? We're gonna have pig's knuckles and sauerkraut tonight, Charlie.
Yeah.
And for dessert, I'm gonna bake fresh blueberry pie.
Blueberry pie? That's my favorite.
I don't remember inviting you to supper, Floyd Smoot. So why don't you put on your mail-order courtin' hair and go callin' on your mail-order sweetheart? And maybe she'll cook you up a mail-order supper.
Kate, I always eat supper here.
That was before I found out what kind of a man you are.
What kind of a man am I, Kate? Tell me again.
You're nothing but a fickle, heartbreaking Casanova, that's what. Come on, Chuck.
Kane wants to hold supper for a while, see if Floyd shows up.
Wait a minute, Joe. The big game with Elm City's coming up. Now, the merchants of Hooterville are prepared to pay you a cash bonus if...
As good as mine. I'm gonna win that game.
The bonus ain't for winning. It's for resigning.
I'll chip in on that.
Now, look here just a minute, you boys. I got a surprise ready for that Elm City team. The Hooterville Hornets are gonna really sting.
Worse than today? Oh, sting.
What's the surprise, Joe?
Speed in the backfield. I got a brand new scat back, under grass. Little but fast as a jackrabbit. Them big heavy Elm City boys ain't gonna lay a hand on her. I mean him. The scat back.
Uncle Joe, you're not by any chance talking about Bettie.
Bettie? Bettie who?
Bettie, my fast-running daughter, that's who.
Oh, Kate, I know you'd never stand still for a thing like that. Would you?
You better believe I wouldn't. Neither would she.
Neither would Hooterville.
I'll bet the Elm City boys would go for it.
I was just joking. Vickery don't mean that much to me.
By the way, where is Bettie Jo? Well,
how would I know?
Bettie Jo!
You better let her do her homework. You know her grades aren't what...
Did you talk her into it, Coach?
Talk her into what?
No, he didn't.
But, Mom, we've just got to win one game. And Uncle Joe says that with me as a scat back...
You scat back upstairs and take off that uniform.
Sorry, Coach. I was ready and willing.
Well, I wasn't.
Nice pass, Mom.
Forget it.
Mom, can't we start serving now? Everything's ready?
Yeah, bring on the pig's knuckles and sauerkraut.
Well, no, let's just wait a little longer for Floyd.
Hey, Kate, I sure thought you had him cured when you told him all the women in the valley were mad about him.
What?
Floyd Smooth? Mother!
Well, I was just... trying to help him mend his broken heart by convincing him he had sex appeal. I guess he didn't believe me.
Well, there's only so big a lie a man can swallow.
That's a whopper.
Oh, you two are a great help. All that Floyd needs is enough people to tell him that he's a handsome, desirable bachelor and he'll be fine. Well, go ahead, girls. Get the blueberry pies out of the oven. I don't think Floyd's coming.
Hey, Mom.
Handsome, desirable bachelor. He's pathetic.
Joe, Floyd is warm, he's affectionate, he's gentle.
He's pathetic.
Now stop that.
Floyd, what are you doing?
Oh, I just couldn't resist the smell of the blueberry pie. But please don't tell your Ma I was here. She's mad at me.
Mom?
Mad at you?
Why, she's crazy about you.
All the women are.
But especially Mom.
And who can blame her? You're strong, you're handsome.
And you're charming and you're intelligent. Why, you're everything a woman could ask for.
Then how come no woman's ever asked for it?
Well,
Because it's a man's place to do the asking, not a woman's.
Yes, a woman's place is in the kitchen.
Now, Mom's waiting for you out in the dining room.
Thanks, you girls. You set me straight.
I still say you men could help give Floyd some self-confidence if you would just...
Keith Bradley, come to my arm.
What?
You're my woman and I'm your man. Now, let's do something about it.
Floyd Smoot, have you been into McCook and Sherry?
No, Kate. I don't need no false courage. I got love. Now, Kate, don't you cry. I know you've waited a long time for this, but it's come at last. I want to marry you. How about it, Judge Drucker?
Well, don't you think you better wait for Kate's answer?
Yes.
You heard her. She said yes.
No, I... What? No, Floyd, you're joking.
Somebody hid my Indian again.
Don't they realize that was carved out of living oak by my great-great-great-uncle, Kit Carson? A thing like that gives the hotel class.
Ooh-wee. If that pig had known what Kate was going to do to his knuckles, he'd have died happy.
Hey, that's my chair.
Kate and Floyd out here? I can't find him anyplace.
Why, are you in a hurry to marry him?
Of course not, but Kate's in her spot. She might need our help.
If you find her, ask her where she hid my Indian.
Oh, Bettie Jo, you got any idea where Floyd and your mother disappeared to?
No, Mr. Drucker. The last I saw Floyd, he was going down to the train to get his guitar.
Oh, no. Poor Kate.
There he is.
Yeah. But where? Where is he? Can anybody tell what direction that's coming from?
No, but I hope the wind changes. Them knuckles I ate's clenching into a fist.
Maybe he's down at the railroad track. Come on, Bettie Jo.
Whew, I'm glad that's over.
Hold it, Charlie.
What's the matter?
Now, let's start over again. When I rock, you rock. Now. Nothing makes me edgier than people rocking against me.
Listen, girls, we've got to scare Floyd out of the notion of wanting to marry me. Now, I got an idea. You know how shy and bashful he is.
Not tonight.
Well, not with me. But when he comes back to help you with the dishes, I'm going to leave. And I want you to ask him to explain about the birds and the bees. Oh, don't worry. He'll run like a scared rabbit.
Oh, Floyd, come in, Floyd. The girls are so happy you're going to help them with the dishes. Aren't you, girls?
We sure are, Daddy Floyd.
Oh, Billie.
Why, Daddy Floyd, you're blushing from ear to ear.
I don't mind us calling you Daddy, but we never had a father to tell us things.
And there's something we'd like you to tell us right now.
What's that?
All about the... birds and the bees.
You don't know about the birds and the bees? Well, I guess you're old enough to learn about the birds and the bees. The birds, I'll tell you about the birds first. And they go like this. Now, you take the bees. They do it all together different. I mean, the sound. It goes... Now, you don't want to get them mixed up because the bees will sting you. Now, just remember, the birds is bigger and goes like this. The bees is littler and goes like this. You sure you don't know about this?
Where have you been?
We've been looking everywhere. Where's Floyd?
Oh, he's in the kitchen, but he's going to come running in here any minute.
What are you playing, hide and seek?
He's going to want to hide because Bobbie Jo and Billie Jo are asking Daddy Floyd to explain about the birds and the bees.
Oh, this I gotta hear.
You go get your books and do your homework.
This I gotta hear.
Me too.
But you don't think that...
With Floyd, it's possible.
Floyd!
Just a minute, Kate.
Girls, have you learned enough?
Yes, Daddy Boy.
Just remember.
Remember.
I'll be back later and tell you about the pigs and the chickens.
Boy.
Come in, Kate. Should I bring my guitar?
No, I just want to talk to you. What am I going to do, Sam?
Mom?
Yes, dear?
Were either one of you good in history? I'm having an awful time.
Yes, Kate, dear.
Here's the man who's going to help you with your homework from now on. Your daddy, Floyd.
Yeah, Floyd. Now, that's something you got to get used to. Helping the girls with their homework.
My teacher always said I was an exceptional bride. What do you want to know, Betty?
Well, right now we're studying the Mexican War.
Are we having a war with Mexico?
Floyd, the Mexican War started over 100 years ago.
And we ain't whipped them yet.
Doggone it, Charlie. If you're gonna rock, rock. Don't sit there side saddle.
I'm sorry, Joe.
All right, now we'll get a fresh start. A one, a two, a rock.
Listen, boys. If we don't help Kate, she's liable to wind up being Mrs. Floyd Smoot.
Terrible name. It's pathetic.
Oh, I have no objection to the name.
I do. Mrs. Smoot. Sounds like a truck dumping wet cement.
I tell you what, Kate, I can fire up the cannonball and sneak you into Pixley. That'll give Floyd overnight to kind of sleep off this love binge he's on.
The old Floyd wouldn't sleep a wink worried about his train.
Boys, you've done it.
I've done what?
Solve the problem. Listen.
I'm glad you changed your mind about a moonlight stroll. You sure you don't want me to go get my guitar?
No, Floyd. Well, we have things to talk about. Now then, you'll run the hotel.
Oh, sure, when I'm not running the train.
Oh, well, I don't think you'll have time for both.
But, Kate, I'm the only one that knows how to fire the...
Why, they ain't nothing to firing a locomotive, boys. Easiest job on earth.
Come on.
I tell you what, Joe, you fire it one day and I'll fire it the next.
Sounds good to me, Sam.
Get down out of there and get your grimy hands off of my wood.
Why, Floyd, you won't have time for the cannonball no more.
You're going to be a married man.
Now, you'll be busy firing Kate Stoke.
Ain't nobody going to fire the Hooterville cannonball but me. Now get yourself down out of there.
Why, Floyd, did I hear right? You mean you're choosing the train instead of me?
Now, Kate, please don't go to bawling again. Doggone it, if I gotta make a choice.
I understand. And I'm gonna be very brave about it. I guess you were a bachelor too long to get snared now.
Kate, I'll take you back to the hotel.
I'll come along.
Me too.
Me too.
Oh, no, Floyd. You stay here with your first and only love.
It isn't my only love, Kate. Please let me go along.
No, Floyd, and that's final.
Well, then, Kate.
What is it, Floyd?
Will you bring me back down some blueberry pie?
Sure, I will. How do you like that? I finished third behind blueberry pie.
This has been a Filmways presentation.
pigs.
Bake a cherry pie, Billy boy, Billy boy. She bake a cherry pie, Chiming Billy. She can bake a cherry pie quick as a cat can wink her eye. She's a young thing and cannot leave her mother.
Well, Granny, did you pick out your spot yet for the garden?
Yep. I kind of favor a patch right close here to the house.
Yeah, well, I'll plow you up something there directly.
Yeah, just enough for some onions and taters and some Rudy Bakers. And a few rows of corn.
Paul? Morning, Granny. Paul, can I help you with the plowing and the spading?
Well, Ellie, I'd rather you put on one of them pretty dresses that Miss Hathaway got you.
But, Paul, I can plow better in these clothes.
Need for plowing. You know, Ellie, I'd like you to wear one of them dresses kind of regular. Wouldn't you, Granny?
You're mighty fetching in a dress, Ellie.
Prettier in a tub of fresh churned butter.
Paul, if I go to wearing them dresses, Jethro will make fun of me.
I reckon he hadn't better. Now, you run along and put on something with skirts.
All right, but he hadn't better make fun.
He won't, he won't. You know, speaking of Jethro, I think he's got himself a sweetheart.
The banker's secretary?
That's right. They was out together last night.
What'd they do?
Well, I don't rightly know for sure, but it was something to do with bowls.
All you do with bowls is eat.
Yeah, I reckon that's what it was then. She said she was going to take him bowling.
You know, Jed, I kind of like that, Miss Hathaway.
Yeah, I think she kind of likes us, too.
Oh, those marvelous Clampetts. Those simple, rugged mountain people. The more I see of them, the more I am impressed.
Yes, now
I have... Never have I observed such strength of body, mind, and character.
Yes, now I...
They stand like boulders on the pebble-strewn landscape of Beverly Hills. Like mighty oaks among bushes. Like...
Like quiet. Now, like I admire them, too. But those boulders need polishing, and we've got to put some city leaves on those oaks before my wife gets back from Boston.
Incidentally, in any endeavor requiring physical strength, they are most exceptional. I took Jethro bowling last night. Here's the bill.
$3,000? How many games did you bowl?
Well, you see, what happened was this. I said to Jethro,
pick up that bowling ball, she says, and see can you knock over them pins down yonder. They's just sticks. Anyway, I snatches up that rascal, draws back, and lets her fly.
Did you knock down them pins?
Yeah. The pins, the pin boy, the end of the building, a brick wall, and a signboard down on Sunset Boulevard.
I bet you Miss Jane didn't do that good.
Well, she didn't even try. But she just looks at me and says, Jethro, you're strong as an ox. And twice as handsome.
Ain't no two ways about it, Granny. That city girl is sweet on this boy.
I reckon so, the way she's bragging on his looks. You are handsomer than an ox.
Thank you, Granny. Cousin Ellie, you're a city girl now. Do you think...
You see there, Paul? I told you this would happen if I took to wearing these dresses. You call me that again, and I'll turn you every way but loose.
Say nothing but city gal.
Ellie, me clamp it. Get up from there, or you're going across my knee.
And Jethro, you're going across mine.
What did I do that was so all fired bad? In that dress, she looks just like a city gal.
You dig him!
I reckon we better go out there and see she don't hurt him.
Now that we're living in a city, you got to learn to use the steps.
You'll be happy to know that I'm making splendid progress with Ellie Mae. She's turning into quite a lady.
Fine. But it's Jed, Granny, and Jethro we've got to work on. Clothes, manners, the works. What have you done about servants?
That's a problem, Chief. They're basically opposed to the whole idea of able-bodied people letting others do their work for them.
Well, that's a refreshing attitude. But we've got to get a skeleton staff in there somehow. A combination butler and valet with Jed and Jethro. To help them assemble a wardrobe, teach them how to... Ravenswood.
Your butler?
Oh, he's never been my butler. Came with my wife like an overweight dowry. Been in her family for years. And with Margaret in Boston, I can certainly spare him, plus her upstairs girl, Marie.
I doubt if you can sell Mr. Clampett on the idea of servants.
Get him on the phone. I'll make him think he's doing me a favor by taking him off my hands for a while.
Right, Chief.
She hadn't ought to have thrown me down on my head like that. What if I'd have been carrying a frog in my hat?
You ain't supposed to be wearing your hat in the house.
Well, Granny, where's a fella gonna carry a frog? They jump out of your pockets.
Hello? Oh, howdy there, Mr. Drysdale. Glad to have you back from Boston. Your missus come with you? Oh, that's too bad. I know her and Granny would hit it off like two sows on a mud waller.
Yes, I'm sure they would. No recipes? No, my wife doesn't do much cooking. No, I doubt if she ever made grits and hog jowls.
Well, how about mustard greens and possum belly? No fooling. Pone and squirrel shank? Boiled chicken hawk. Well, say, she don't do much cooking, does she?
No. Well, the reason I called Mr. Clampett is I have a butler. Well, he really belongs to my wife's family, but he's been with us ever since we were married. And I was wondering if you'd let him come and stay with you for a while.
You mean board with us?
Well, I guess you could call it that.
Who's going to board with us?
Just a minute. Some kin of Miss Drysdale named Butler. Oh, why, we be just...
That's that no good fat rascal that wouldn't let Ellie and me in to help Miss Drysdale when she was sobering up.
Hello? Granny was talking at me, but she's done now.
Oh, no, she ain't.
Just a minute. Granny, let me hear the men out, and then we can talk it over. Yes, sir, Mr. Drysdale, I'm a-listening now.
Well, in addition to Ravenswood, he's the butler, you can also have my wife's upstairs girl, Marie. Margaret may be away for some time, and I have absolutely no use for him.
Well, I sure would like to oblige you. Me and Granny will talk it over, and I'll call you.
Oh, thank you. You'll be doing me a great favor.
I was glad to help out when I can.
Thank you again, Mr. Clampett, and goodbye.
Is somebody coming to live with us, Uncle Jed?
Maybe, Jethro, maybe. Why don't you go out and make up with your cousin Ellie?
Okay, Uncle Jed.
All right, Jed. Let's have it. We gonna board that butler fella?
Well, Mr. Drysdale will take it mighty kindly if we did. He says he ain't got no use for him.
I don't like him myself.
Eddie, you only met him once.
Once was enough. I asked him real nice. I said, are you a-doing for Ms. Drysdale that she's feeling poorly? Are you doing the washing and the scrubbing and the cleaning for her? And he looks right down his nose at me and says, Madam, I am a butler.
I reckon he is proud of his name. Kind of fancy. Ravenswood Butler.
I don't care if it's Stonewall Jackson. And I think Mr. Drysdale has a lot of gall to ask us to take his wife's kinfolks off his hands.
Well, now, I'm mighty beholden to him. You know, he's keeping my $25 million in his bank, and he ain't charging me one penny to do it.
That's his business. You didn't ask him to do it.
Well, now, Granny, if it was just Mr. Butler, I might agree with you, but there's a sad side to the story, too.
What's that?
Well, you've heard of Mr. Drysdale speak of his stepson? That's his wife's boy by her first marriage?
The one they call Sonny?
Yeah. Well, it seems she's got a girl, too, and there must be something wrong with her.
What?
Well, I don't know, but they keep her upstairs.
No.
Yeah. He spoke of her as my wife's upstairs girl.
The poor thing.
Her name's Marie, and he'd like us to take her and Mr. Butler.
Doggone it, kid. We got enough to do to take care of this big place without... He didn't say what was ailing her, huh?
Well, no, but if you ask me, they ain't eating right over there.
No.
You know what Mr. Drysdale told me?
What?
His wife ain't never cooked grits and hog jowls.
Ah, oh, go on.
That's a fact. Nor mustard greens and possum belly. Nor pone and squirrel shank. Nor even boiled chicken hawk.
The land of mercy.
You can't hardly blame Mr. Butler for getting the mite cranky. Man don't eat right, he gets that way.
Well, dear, I reckon it won't do no harm to take him in for a spell.
Granny, for such a little woman, you got an awful big heart.
Well, I feel sorry for the poor girl. But the first time that fancy pants Mr. Butler looks down his nose at me, I'm gonna chuck him in the cement pond.
I'm doubling your salaries for the length of time you stay at the Clampett home. But if one word of this gets back to my wife in Boston, you're both out of work with no references.
Actually, you will find the Clampetts to be basically fine people. All they need is a little polish.
Polish? They need sandblasting. However, I think Miss Hathaway's plan may overcome their initial resentment of wearing city clothes.
Yes, I think I have devised rather a clever strategy. To put it briefly and succinctly, my strategy is as follows. I shall propose to the Clampetts that they sit for a family portrait. As you know, my hobby is painting. Now, I shall suggest to the Clampetts that their attire match their background, which is, of course, their beautiful mansion. They will no doubt see the logic of my didactic approach, accede to my wishes, don suitable raiment, and, once they have seen themselves thus attired, take...
We're in. Let's go.
We forgot to dust the stair rail. I'll do it, Granny. Bye. Wearing boys' clothes does come in handy sometimes.
Hi, Ginger Granny. I think we got her all spick and span for the company.
They ain't a speck of dirt, no place. Can I go swimming now?
Me too.
As soon as we help Granny clean up the kitchen. Was that music again?
Sure is good. You ever find out where that comes from?
Know 'em, Granny. Every single time I commence to looking for it, somebody comes to the door.
Nobody to the door now?
There will be. You'll see.
Doggies, that's nice. What outfit you in see can we find?
You're wasting your time. I'm a-telling you, before you can find it, somebody will come to the door. There, you see? Happens every time.
Now remember, Ravenswood, I'm counting on you. Don't fail me.
You have my word, sir. I've been butler and valet since boyhood, as was my father before me and his father before him. And I've yet to meet the man or woman who posed a social problem too difficult for me to handle.
That's the spirit.
Howdy there.
Remember me, Mr. Butler?
No!
Ravenswood, come back! You gave your word! Come back, you coward! Come back here! I'll cut off your fringe benefits!
Ravenswood probably forgot something. He'll return shortly. Meanwhile, this is Marie. Mrs. Drysdale's upstairs girl. Marie? J.D. Clampett?
Howdy.
Jethro Bodine? Ellie Mae Clampett? And Grandma Clampett?
No, ma'am. I am a Moses.
Pardon?
Granny's related on my wife's side. They's the Moses family from Tennessee.
Then your name is Granny Moses? Grandma Moses.
That's right.
There was a very famous Grandma Moses who painted primitives.
I've whitewashed a few myself.
I'll show Marie to her room.
Listen, Marie, honey. Over here, you've got the run of the house. You don't have to hide upstairs. Ain't nothing wrong with that girl, but what some good cooking will cure her? She's half starved.
Poor thing is so weak, her knees keeps a buckling on her.
She's kind of pretty, though, for a skinny girl.
Just wait till she gets a mess of Granny's grits and hog jowls. That'll fill her out.
Well, I'll get some of cooking. Guess that butler fellow will be coming back directly.
Oh, and Granny,
We have some of that salted down possum belly that Ma sent us.
Well, I reckon it is kind of a company meal.
Granny, open up a jar of them pickled crow gizzards.
Now, Jeff, we don't want to spoil these folks. They might get to thinking we eat like that every day.
Baby, will you do something nice for me?
I sure, Paul.
Will you go get into that pretty dress again?
Oh, Paul, Jethro will make fun of me.
No, I won't, Ellie Mae. Cross my heart.
Why?
That's my darling. Thank you. And then you be real nice to Marie. She's had a bad life.
I'll be nice to her. She's pretty.
Let's all be nice.
Far. I wanted to go swimming. Now I gotta go put on an old dress.
Cousin Allie, you look awful pretty in a dress. Honest you do.
Do I look pretty in that there city girl?
You look prettier than that there city girl.
That did it. Come on and fight.
Now, Ellie, come on, Ellie.
There's nothing to be afraid of, Ravenswood. The fact that they're big and strong doesn't mean they're violent. Elephants can be gentle.
Now, Ravenswood, your letting appearances deceive you.
Oh, really,
sir? Oh, I do admit on the surface they do seem a bit rough, even cruel. But I assure you, underneath, they are placid, kindly, and gentle. See?
You shouldn't have called me a city girl.
Ellie Mae, leave me alone, please, Ellie Mae.
You called me a city girl.
Ellie Mae. Mr. Butler, don't never say anything nice to that girl. She'll kill you.
Ravenwood, come back here. Coward, come back. You promised. Ravenwood.
I found her granny when Mr. Drysdale said he didn't have no use for Mr. Butler. He sure wasn't fooling. I just seen him cut through the brush chasing him with a stick.
If Mr. Butler gets sassy with me, I'll chase him with more than a stick.
Jan, Ellie throwed me down on my head again. If she don't stop that, I'm going to get a headache.
Stop rowing her, Jethro.
But golly, all I said was she's pretty. That ain't no call to bust a fella's head.
Pardon.
Oh, howdy, Marie.
Hi, Marie.
Are you hungry, darling?
No, madam.
I'm whopping up something here to just set your mouth to watering.
Put some strength in your limbs, too.
Tell her what it is, Granny.
A great big mess of grits and hog jowls.
And salted down possum belly.
Oh, pickled crow gizzards. How do you like that?
Don't tell me that child ain't hungry. Why, she's ready to drop in her tracks. Set her at the table and I'll dish up a mess.
No, please. I only came in to bring you a message from Miss Hathaway. She's preparing to paint the family portrait. And she wishes to know if you all will sit for her. May I tell her that you will sit for her?
Well, yeah, I reckon we'll do that.
Merci.
Well, let's get at it.
Sitting? Yeah, I reckon.
Found out something about Marie.
What?
She's scared of Mr. Butler.
How'd you know?
I asked her to go swimming with me, and she says he wouldn't allow it.
What business is it of his?
That's what I says. And she says he's a butler, and I'm just an upstairs girl. And I got to do whatever he says.
We'll see about this. Ah, dingies. Let's hit Mr. Drysdale, find him, and give him a whooping. I'll catch him, Granny.
Oh, Ellie, you go put a dress on like you promised.
Uncle Jed, I'm going swimming. If I see him, I'll fetch him in.
Don't go jumping in with your clothes on again.
Well, I won't, Uncle Jed. Miss Hathaway, she gave me a present last night. She says it's something special for her to go swimming in.
What'd she give you?
Oh, a pair of trunks.
You go swimming in a cement pond. Boy, it's too big to go swimming in a trunk.
Ed?
Even a pair of them.
I got a feeling that Mr. Butler feller is gonna be trouble.
Yeah, we can handle him.
Well, I still say that I think Mr. Drysdale has a lot of nerve to ask us to board his wife's relations.
Maybe he just fed up. Man can get awful tired of having his wife's kin underfoot all the time.
He told me that Butler fella had been living with them ever since they was married. I declare some in-laws latch on to free room and board like leeches. It takes a mule kick to jar them loose. You can't hardly blame Mr. Drysdale for trying to get shed of a critter like that.
Is that the way you feel?
You bet it is.
I'll see how fast I can get packed. I'll get out from underfoot just as quick as I can. No, Jeff. I know when I'm not wanted. It don't take no mule kick to get shed of me.
Darnation, Granny, I wasn't talking about you. We couldn't get along without you.
No, Jeff. I'm just a burdensome old woman. No good to nobody. Why don't you throw me down the well? Go ahead, pick me up, carry me out to the well, and throw me in.
Stop talking like that.
Uncle Dan! I caught him. Mr. Drysdale, he gave out, but I caught this fat little rascal.
Put him there.
You gonna whip me, Granny?
No, Jethro. I'm going to get thrown down the well. Why don't you throw us both down the well together? We're just no good leeches, both.
Mr. Butler, I'm sorry Jethro got a mite rough with you. He don't mean no harm. He's just an overgrown boy. Now, we're all mighty pleasure to have you come and stay with us, and as long as you behave yourself, won't be no trouble. Oh, I'm Jed Clampett.
Sir.
Is your granny?
Madam.
I reckon you and Jethro done met.
Yeah.
Sir.
Oh, and this here is my daughter, Ellie Mae.
Enchanté, mademoiselle. Vous êtes très belle, très charmant, très ravissant.
Don't you dare use them kind of words to a lady.
What do you say, Granny?
I ain't sure, but it sounded dirty.
You said your daughter was pretty and charming. Oh, you're so different from all the others. You're like a beautiful city girl.
He had not have said that.
Oh, Marie.
Oui, Miss Jane.
Didn't you say the Clampetts had agreed to sit for their portrait?
They said they would do it.
No! What is this?
I believe it to be self-preservation, madam.
No!
Don't take to the stairs. She'll catch you, sure.
I say now, let me go. Now, really.
No! No!
Sounds like Ellie got him.
Free to.
Could somebody please tell me what is transpiring?
Uncle Jed. Ellie throwed him all right, but I caught him before he hit the floor.
So here you are. Well, now, everything seems to be fine. You see, Ravenswood, didn't I tell you the Clampetts were kindly, gentle people?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
We're going to have to feed up both of them, Granny. His knees is buckling, too.
I shall call it Invictus.
Ma'am?
Invictus, you know. Or perhaps you don't. Thank whatever gods may be for your unconquerable soul. Henley.
Yeah.
Jethro, look more thoughtful. That's really a little more than I am.
Ellie Mae's got Kellogg's cornflakes.
Well, so she has, but she's not putting on a face like that.
Well, no. She's got Kellogg's cornflakes. I ain't.
You don't have to look quite so sad. You may have some cornflakes as soon as I'm through with the sketch. Unless they're all gone. Do you remember if there's another box? Great! Hold it!
K-E-L-L-O, double good Kellogg's, best to you. The Beverly Hillbillies has been presented by Kellogg's Corn Flakes. From Kellogg's of Battle Creek.
Come ride the little train that is rolling down the tracks to the junction. Forget about your cares, it is time to relax at the junction. Lots of curves, you bet, and even more when you get to the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
There's a little hotel called the Shady Rest at the Junction.
Petticoat Junction.
It is run by Kate. Come and be her guest at the Junction.
Petticoat Junction.
And that's Uncle Joe. He's a moving kind of slow at the Junction. Petticoat Junction.
Are you kidding? With those mosquitoes dive-bombing me all night?
We're having unusually warm weather.
You also have unusually large mosquitoes. Did you ever hear of screens?
Oh, yes, sir. We're getting new ones today. Bobbie Jo, Mr. Blake needs some coffee.
What I really need is a transfusion.
Hey, you know something? You got some crazy hummingbirds around this hotel.
Hummingbirds?
Yeah, they kept flying in my window last night, stabbing me with those long beaks.
Oh, well, we're getting new screens today.
Well, either that or get me a hungry cat.
Good morning, Mr. Gordon.
Morning. Man, I can't decide which of these sisters is prettier.
I see what you mean.
Hey, how would you girls like to double date tonight?
Double date?
Yeah, just the three of us.
How about some breakfast?
Yes, sir, right away.
And fry up some of those mosquitoes.
Well, there'll be new screens today, Mr. Blake.
So I keep hearing.
Well, we're having very unusual weather.
I know.
You think they're going to check out?
Not if we get those new screens up today.
Well, you better put an extra pan of bacon on the stove. A good breakfast will help take their mind off the mosquitoes.
Okay. Train's in, Mom.
Are the screens on it?
Must be. Floyd said there's something in the baggage car for us.
Oh, at last. Why aren't you down there helping unload them?
Uncle Joe sent me away. Said he'd rather handle it himself.
Well, that's a lot of nonsense. The more hands, the faster. I tell you, Bobbie and Billie can handle the breakfast, and you and I will go help unload those beautiful new screens. With new screens, they don't get extra bacon.
Hey, Billy, you know something? That Mr. Gordon's cute.
Well, he's kind of a wolf.
Yeah, I know. And I worry about you being in there alone here. Mom.
Yes, dear.
Bettie,
Joe. Two new salesmen?
More like one.
Well, one's better than none. Where is he?
Hey, you might say he's standing right here.
Oh, you're a salesman now.
Well, not exactly, no. Technically, it's more like a
franchised agent.
Oh, fine. Well, you tell me all about it while we carry up the screens, huh?
Okay.
Huh?
Screens didn't come.
Oh, no. Well, that's the last time that I order screens through a magazine ad. They said that if I would mail the money in advance, that they would guarantee delivery within... You did send the money, didn't you, Uncle Joe?
Oh, sure I did.
Well, it was the last $70 we had in the world. In fact, it's Billie Joe's college money.
Oh, I know that, Kate.
Uncle Joe, tell me you didn't spend that money.
I didn't.
Oh.
I invested it.
Oh, in what? What's in those suitcases?
144 cans of Lord and Lady Violet cologne.
You call that an investment?
But wouldn't you? You put out $70, you get back 140, and maybe more.
I think I better sit down.
That's a good idea. I'll explain finance to you.
Before you do that, explain what we're going to do about the mosquitoes coming up from the swamp that are biting us out of business.
Well, that's simple. We'll leave the windows closed. You see,
Uncle Joe, this is the hottest Indian summer we've had in 50 years.
You didn't let me finish. You see, when I double or maybe triple your money on that cologne, we can air condition this entire hotel.
Uncle Joe?
I couldn't find any screens, Mom, but these were down by the track.
Another 144 cans?
288 cans of little pressurized moneymakers. This is only the first shipment. Can I talk them into giving me the exclusive franchise for this whole half of the state?
Honey, run quick to the kitchen and tell Billie Joe to fry up some extra bacon. Uncle Joe, how could this happen?
I can't take all the credit, Kate. It must have been the hand of destiny that put that ad for screens right next to this glorious opportunity that I'd been looking for all my life. Here, read this.
My eyes are too full of tears.
Yeah, I get misty-eyed, too, when I think of all the money that's going to come rolling in.
I'm thinking of the money that's gone rolling out. Billie Joe's college money.
I'll send that girl to one of the best colleges in the country. Listen to this. How Mr. A.J. Simmons of Lamar, Missouri, earns $90 a week in his spare time as franchise agent for Lord and Lady Violet Cologne. Did you hear that, Kate? That's just in his spare time. I'm going to work full time. That'll mean $200-$300 a week more.
Uncle Joe, let's go have some breakfast.
Not for me. I got work to do. I got sales campaigns to organize, distribution to map out, bookkeeping to set up. Kate, can't you just hear opportunity knocking?
Hear it? I got a splitting headache from it.
She's a fine little woman. She just don't understand business.
Billy, you know why Mom's so worried about the screens not coming?
Sure, she's afraid those salesmen are gonna check out.
No, more than that. We're going to have royalty staying right here.
Royalty? Uncle Joe says the Shady Rest Hotel is going to be the headquarters of Lord and Lady Violet.
Well, who are they? Tell me about him.
Well, he went tearing off before I could ask. He said he had to practice his presentation.
Well, we've got some practicing to do if we're going to be presented to royalty.
Bend.
Your ladyship. Charmed, Your Grace.
Good morning, ladies. Could I have a moment of your time to introduce Lord and Lady Violet?
They're here! Uncle Joe, you should have told us.
Well, you're a myth.
Glad, girls, you're making me forget my speech. Has romance disappeared from your lives? Has your husband and boyfriend lost interest in you? Let Lady Violet bring back that gleam in his eye. And for the man in your life, we have a rugged, masculine fragrance, Lord Violet. Yes, girls, promise him anything, but give him...
Uncle Joe, what in the world are you talking about?
I'm talking about that new fragrance that set all London to talking. There's Lady Violet Cologne for females and Lord Violet Cologne for males.
Cologne?
This ain't ordinary cologne, lady. Lord and Lady Violet represent a startling new breakthrough in the field of smell.
Hey, you!
What's burning?
Nothing, Mother. It must be Uncle Joe's cologne.
That's the smell you're hoping to get money for?
Well, now, Kate, The kitchen ain't exactly the place to demonstrate a subtle fragrance. Come on outside in the clear, pure, fresh air and let Lady Violet have a fair shake.
I got plenty shook right here. I don't need another whiff.
Well, now, come on.
Kate, stop clowning.
Who's clowning? I don't want that stuff in my kitchen.
Well, be fair, Kate. You haven't even smelled Lord Violet from in yet.
It doesn't matter. They all smell...
Oh, Mom, it can't be as bad as all that. Ooh! Where did Uncle Joe get it?
I don't know. Ask A.J. Simmons of Lamar, Missouri.
Who's A.J. Simmons? Is he a friend of Uncle Joe?
Yeah, you bet he is. A.J. Simmons makes $90 a week just in his spare time. He doesn't even have to budge out of Lamar, Missouri.
He better not if he knows what's good for him.
Mother just doesn't understand business.
Understand this business. Now, you pack up all 288 cans of this stuff, and we're taking them into Sam Drucker's store.
Hey, now you're catching on, Kate. That's a good idea. I'll franchise Drucker for Hooterville.
What do you mean, sell to Drucker for 25 cents a can? That's what I paid for it.
All I want to do is get Billie Joe's college money back so I can buy new screens.
Kate, you still don't understand profit and loss. If you sell at cost, it's bad business.
It's bad cologne.
No, but sales-wise and market-wise, if you ain't got a markup, you take a beating profit-wise.
We're already taking a beating mosquito-wise.
I don't know. I'm satisfied with the brand of coffee I've been selling.
Yeah, but Mr. Drucker, these are better coffee beans. They're aged.
Well, so am I. Can't say it helped me any. Now, if you'll excuse me, I got a couple of my favorite customers to wait on.
Mind if I check your stock in the back room?
No, go right ahead. Well, what'll it be, folks?
Well, I'll tell you the truth, Sam. We're not buying today. We're selling.
You, Kate? You're selling?
Well, Uncle Joe and I together are.
Against my better business judgment.
What is it you're selling against your better business judgment?
Show him, Uncle Joe.
Lord or lady?
Both.
Which one first? Hold it, Sam. Now, before you open that, I want to ask you a question.
Shoot.
Now, this may be a shot in the dark, but did you ever make the acquaintance of an A.J. Simmons in Lamar, Missouri?
Who's he?
Never mind, Sam. Your time's valuable, and we don't want to waste it.
Thank you, Kate. Oh, hey, I remember this stuff.
Lord Violet?
No, cologne. I stocked 6 bottles of it in 1934. Got 5 left. 1 broke.
That's the beauty of Lord Violet. Comes in the new unbreakable spray can.
Oh, yeah. Hey, it's got that push-button gizmo.
I wouldn't do that, Sam.
Why not?
Well, you don't want to waste one precious puff of Lord Violet, the rugged masculine fragrance that drives women crazy.
I'll go along with that.
Excuse me. Did I hear somebody talking about Lord Violet?
Yeah, why?
Well, that's the first line I ever represented. Lord and Lady Violet Cologne. I was only 12 years old. Answered an ad in a magazine. Something about how Mr. A.J. Simmons of Lamar, Missouri, earned $40 a week in his spare time.
You hear that, Kate? $40 then, now it's up to 90. We're not selling to Sam Drucker for cost. We got a gold mine here.
Just a minute, Uncle Joe. How well did you do with Lord and Lady Violet?
Well, I got my folks a new car out of it.
And you were only 12 years old?
Yeah. A bottle of it exploded in their car and stunk it up so bad they had to buy a new one.
Oh, don't listen to this salesman, Sam. Just professional jealousy talk.
Oh, why should I be jealous? I don't sell cologne.
Yeah, you bet you don't. This is our territory.
Forget it, Uncle Joe. $70 wouldn't have started Billie Joe in college anyway. And as for the screens, we'll buy the guests fly swatters and hope for cooler weather. Bye, Sam.
Now you're talking, Kate. We can sell that cologne for $2 a can minimum.
Kate. Wait a minute. You got $70 tied up in this cologne?
Yeah, plus 2 of mine. But taking 2 gross, I got it for 25 cents a can. Pretty shrewd buying, eh, Sam?
Yes, it was. You cornered the market, and that's bad for my business. Listen, Kate, will you sell me the whole lot of it for $75?
No thanks, Sam.
You bet no thanks. He'd sell it for $2 a can. Let's see, 288 cans, that'd come to... Well, it'd come to a lot. We might as well have it.
Listen, Kate, will you take $80?
Thanks anyway, Sam.
Yeah, thanks for what? Stealing the money out of our pocket?
Here's the train. Let's get back to the hotel.
Kate, you get on back to the hotel. I'm going to start house to house here in Hooterville. A couple of $100 worth of daylight selling time left.
You're going to sell 144 cans here in Hooterville? There aren't that many people.
After I saturate this burg, I'm going to hit a few farms on the way back.
You're going to walk all the way back to the hotel with those heavy bags?
Well, they won't be heavy for long, and paper money don't weigh much.
Okay, I'll see you back at the...
Melon wheat, Drucker. This stuff's gonna put you out of business.
You're not kidding.
Knocking yourself out.
I don't mind.
What happened to your helpers?
Yeah, where'd those big sisters of yours disappear, too?
They're waiting for the train. Mother may be on it.
Those screens better be on it, or I'll meet it on the way back.
Why don't you gentlemen come inside where the mosquitoes won't bother you?
Ow! You know, she's got a point there. The big ones couldn't get through the door.
Let's give it a try.
It's cooler in there, too. And I'll fix you some nice, cool lemonade.
We'll see if you can find those nice, cool sisters of yours.
Thank you, boys.
Hey, did you have any luck, Mom?
Looks like you
sold two cases. Did Mr. Drucker buy them?
How much did you get?
Hey, where's Uncle Joe?
Let's sit down a minute, girls, and I'll answer your questions. Now... Starting with the last one, where's Uncle Joe? He's between here and Hooterville trying to peddle 144 cans of, pressurized disappointment.
What do you say, Fred? How many cans of Lord Violet can it put you down for?
Well, I'll tell you, Joe. A man in my line of business ain't got too much need for cologne. Gabby! Tour! Tour! Tour!
Say, Fred, has it ever occurred to you that a pig farmer might be among those most likely to offend?
Offend who?
Whoever he meets up with.
Well, a pig farmer meets up with the pig buyers. They ain't no more fragrant than we are. Get over there, Alice. Let Myrtle have some of that slop. There you are.
Yeah, well, now about this cologne. You could set a style. You go to market just once, not smelling like a pig. All the others will want to jump on the bandwagon.
You don't seem to get the point. A good pig man don't care. He's got the smell of pigs in his blood.
I'm giving you an opportunity to get it out. Here, I'll give you a free whiff. Lord Violet.
No, ain't it?
Look how that fits the hand. All you got to do is just press that button like this.
Uh-huh.
How do you like it? How do you like it?
Ain't bad, is it?
You better sign up for a dozen cans right now. Not run the risk of me running out.
How much are they?
Well, now they retail in the city for $2 a can.
Goodbye.
Now, wait a minute, Fred. This ain't the city. For you, Fred, 50 cents a can?
Well, that's more like it, but I don't need a dozen cans.
Half a dozen cans.
Well,
What do they know? They're only pigs.
Might be only pigs to you, but to me and my wife, they're bread and butter.
Give them time to adjust to it.
No, I'm sorry. I'm not interested.
Where are you going, Fred?
I'm going to the house and take a bath.
Well, here, take this Lord Violet with you. If Ruthie likes it as well as you, you might want to change your mind about it.
No chance. If I got to choose between my wife and the pigs, I'll have to take the pigs.
Wait a minute, Fred. How's Ruthie been looking to you lately?
What do you mean?
I mean, has she got that old charm, that sparkle, that excitement?
Frankly, no.
Buddy? Right here in this suitcase, I've got 72 cans of instant romance. Lady Violet, you let Ruthie sprinkle a little of this on and you can't resist her. You'll be powerless to resist her. You'll grab her in your arms. You'll smother her with kisses. Now, how many cans are you going to want?
You open that thing and I'll take this stick to you.
What?
Ruthie's a good cook and a hard worker, but there is the ugliest woman the Lord ever let loose.
If we don't do something real quick, Mr. Blake and Mr. Gordon are going to check out.
Oh, dear. I don't want to lose their business. They're Cracker Jack salesmen.
Mom, I've got an idea. If anyone can sell Lord and Lady Violet cologne, it's those two.
Well, I'm sure of that, honey, but how do we sell it to them?
Oh, I know how to do that.
You sit down.
Now, listen, Mom. Now, Mr. Gordon is sort of a wolf, and he's always asking Bobbie and me for dates.
I know, I know.
Listen, I've got an idea. Here comes in.
We all alone?
Just you and me and the mosquitoes, and I'm getting out. If I'm going to be a donor, I'd rather give it to the Red Cross.
Mr. Blake?
Screens come?
Not yet.
I'm checking out.
Please, Mr. Gordon, we're talking about something very important. Well, listen, Billie, what kind of cologne was this salesman wearing?
It was called Lord Violet.
Oh, I heard that makes a man absolutely irresistible.
Oh, does it ever?
Gee, I wish I knew a boy who wore Lord Violet cologne.
You're too young.
Well, what happened?
Anyway, Mother caught us necking on the porch.
Billie, he wasn't even good looking.
I couldn't help myself. He was wearing Lord Violet.
What happened after Mom caught you?
Well, Mother ordered him away, but he left me two suitcases full of Lord and Lady Violet as a present.
Oh, Billie! You can sell it and make a fortune.
Why, I never thought of that.
Where is it?
It's around in the porch. I didn't want Mom to see it.
Well, come on.
Come on, Kate, will you?
Hmm? Oh, are you sure you won't stay for supper? We're having fried chicken.
Look, by supper, I'll be too weak to fight the mosquitoes for it. Will you hurry up so I won't miss my train?
All right, now, let's talk business. You say it sold for a dollar a can.
That's what I heard.
How much for the whole works?
Gee, I don't know anything at all about business.
How about 50 bucks?
90.
60.
80.
70.
Sold.
Hey, Jim. I'm taking on a brand new line.
Oh, that Lord and Lady Violet cologne.
You've heard of it?
Mr. Blake, you're going to miss your train.
Heard of it? You know, when I was a little kid, I read an ad in a magazine. Some guff about a fella named,
Simmons.
Simmons. Making $25 to $30 a week selling this junk, so I bit.
Never made a sale. The smell got on my clothes. I couldn't get near a customer close enough to make my pitch. Even my own dog bit me.
The girls say it's great. Maybe they've changed it, improved it.
If they've changed it, they've improved it.
Stand back, girls.
Look, it killed him.
No, it didn't. He's still breathing.
No, I mean the mosquito. Look, there goes another one.
And another one. And another.
Oh, my goodness, they're dropping like flies. I mean mosquitoes.
Give me that.
Hey, look at him fall.
How about that?
Man, it really stones them. Give me back my insecticide. I've got the hottest new item here since DDT.
Hey, girls, could you give me a hand?
Hey, two more cases. These are mine.
Oh, no, they're not.
Are these full?
All 144 cans.
I'll give you $75 for both of them.
I'll make it 80.
85. 90. $100.
Sold.
There you go.
Hey, Jim. Oh. Wait a minute, Jim. Let's make a deal. We'll split the territory.
Hey, look what I just did. Sold out for $100. I told you that was good cologne. And I still got half my stock left.
Oh, no, you haven't. Billie Jo sold the other two cases for 70.
70? She just lost me $30. When are you women gonna learn you don't belong in business? From now on, leave these things to me.
Yes, Uncle Joe.
What's A.J. Simmons gonna think?
Yes, Uncle Joe.
Well, Bettie, he hasn't got four females holding him back.
Yes, Uncle Joe.
This has been a Filmways presentation.
And now, folks, it's time to say goodnight. We sincerely appreciate your patronage and hope we've succeeded in bringing you an enjoyable evening of entertainment. Please drive home carefully and come back again soon. Good night.